go. So we are now in lecture number 3, and today's topic will be tidy data, the format that basically allowed us to work as smoothly with our data as we did in lecture number 2, for example, where we made extensive use of the dplyr package to wrangle our data. But before we get into that, let me actually just do a little recap of lecture number 1 and 2, sort of like a speed run of both. So for that, let's jump right into our studio. This is actually the lecture script for number 3. But let's do a little recap. So first thing first we want to do when we work on a new project is to create a new project. So on the top right corner, we click new project. We want to do this in a new directory for now. And let's make it just a directory on the desktop. Right, that's a nice fresh start. We have nothing here. We have our terminal, which in your case might be in the bottom left, because I rearranged things a bit. So I usually like to work in our Markdown documents. So let's choose our Markdown here. And I use HTML as the output format. This is just the example of a Markdown document. If I knit this with Ctrl-Shift-K or by saving it first. So we save it first and then we knit it, Ctrl-Shift-K or clicking the knit button. This is what it looks like. We have our setup. We have some front meta, some metadata about our document, which will be used in the document output. For example, this is the title here. This is the author. And then we have some text, which is using the Markdown format. So we can format things, making them bold or italics, for example. And then we have our code, but also the output of set code. So. And we can include plots. This is just a base R plot. We will be using ggplot because it just gives us way, way more power while simultaneously being easier to learn. So the learning curve is a bit better. So first things first, I usually delete this example stuff here. And let's make a new heading. And the first subheading is going to be, let's say, first we load some packages, data. We will be using the tidyverse. So let's load it here. And no other packages so far. What we want to do is get some data. And in order to do that, we actually need to hop over to our desktop folder. And on there, I actually already have this data folder in this other project I made. All right, so let's copy it over because we will be using the gapminder CSV file for this example. So our data, let's call it gapminder, going to come from read CSV from the data folder 02 gapminder.csv. And let's put it below as well so it executes right away and we can see a preview of what's happening. Sometimes it expands a bit too much, so I just pull it back in and pull it back out. So let's demonstrate a couple of things we learned yesterday using the dplyr package. The first thing is the pipe, which means we are taking something from the left and piping it into a function on the right side. Right now, there's an unexpected end because, well, we are not giving it any functions yet. So let's show you something I actually haven't shown you before. I showed you how to select columns. I didn't show you how to exclude specific columns. And for this, you just use the minus sign. So select everything but, for example, everything but the, let's say, GDP. We don't care about the GDP today. And now this is a subset of our data. Now we filter for something like let's only use the countries New Zealand. And because we are there right now, I'm there, use Germany as well. And now let's do some calculations. Oh, actually, first let's show what we can do by using group by. Let's say now we group by country. And then we summarize. Let's say we want to know the mean life expectancy of those countries. Life EXP. And now we're getting the mean life expectancy for both of those countries. Let's finish this analysis, sort of, with a little visualization. We take the whole Gapminder data set again, and let's pipe it into a ggplot. First thing is already covered, we already supplied the data argument, but the second argument, the mapping, we need to create using the function AES for aesthetics. And what I want to do in right now is on the x-axis I want the year, on the y-axis I want to see the population, which can be a bit confusing because this one here is a column in our data set. The other one is the data set which is included in R as an example data set. So we want pop here. And let's add some geometric objects to represent our data. I think let's go with lines. Makes the most sense for time series. And we don't want everything connected by a single line. What we want to do is group things by country. And now we can also, oh, we can color things by continent. And now let's use facet wrap to separate things out a bit. Notice now the thumb things are really hard to see because they are on very, very different scales. And in order to do that in the facet wrap, we can set scales to 3, meaning they can have different scales on the sides. All right. And before we are finished, we need to, of course, make sure that everything knits using the knit button or Ctrl-Shift-K. And this is then our little report. Oh, there's a bunch of warnings and messages that we don't really need in our output. The most important thing, of course, is our plot, which we would want to highlight. So let's set warnings to false. And also message false. I clicked the wrong button. Here we go. All right. And now let's jump back to our actual lecture number 3, where we talk about tidy data. So, what is this tidy data? It is a format in which data can be in, and it has very clear specifications, which makes it very easy to work with. Once you have your data in this tidy format, it will play very well together with the dplyr package, so you're wrangling your data with ease, and it will play especially well with the ggplot package. So, visualizing your data and trying out different styles and types of visualizations will be very, very easy if your data is already tidy. But of course, data doesn't always come in a tidy format, and this is why today we will talk about how to get your data there and how to reshape your data into all the different forms it can have. So in the end, you should feel like Neo in the Matrix, and you're able to manipulate your data frames into all sorts of shapes and forms. All right, so what is this tidy data? The basic idea, and it's illustrated here in the graphics from the book R for Data Science, which, by the way, is a great resource. The link here. R for Data Science by Hedley Wickham, who also wrote dplyr, who also wrote ggplot. And he's now, I think, lead data scientist at RStudio and researching how we can work with data better so they are continuously making the tools better. So it's a great resource to look through, and much of the course is also based on Alpha Data Science. So I'm just mentioning this because the graphic comes from there, but also because it's a great resource. The main idea behind tidydata is that in your data frame, which we have seen a couple of before, every column is a variable, a feature of your data. If we are talking about, say, I think it's easier with an example. Let's look at the penguins, actually. If you're talking about penguins, every column is a feature that one penguin can have. And every row is an observation of all those features for one particular penguin. And in the case of penguins, it's very, very nice. You always know one row corresponds to exactly one penguin. And sometimes, of course, it's harder to know what constitutes one thing, one observation. But here, it's one penguin in one specific year, and this penguin has a bunch of properties, like it has a sex, it has body mass, all those features, all those variables. This can also be confusing because variables is also the name we use for the boxes where we store things in R and in other programming languages. But a variable in statistics and data science and all that is also just a feature that some observations can have. Right. So how do we get our data into this format if it's not already in there? And this can sometimes be tricky, but luckily we have the tidyR package. If you click on this little link here, it will open up the help page for tidyR, and the cheat sheet, as always, is very very helpful. It also specifies once again what tidydata is and links to this vignette about tidydata, which is a more informal version of the full paper on this concept of tidydata. So if you're into reading papers, this is a very good read, actually. It's very well written. And this one is a bit more informal. It's also, it's like, I guess I'd say even better written. Right? It's more, even more focused on understanding. So this whole idea of tidydata is based on database management and comes from an idea called Codd's third normal form, but we are not going to talk about the background here. We want to actually apply it. The trickier thing here is that just like Leo Tolstoy said about families, where every family, happy families are all alike, every unhappy family is unhappy in its own way. The same applies to data, as Hedley Wickham already said. So once we know how to recognize how datasets can be untidy, it will be easier for us to tidy data. So let's look at a tidy example first. And this is already included in the tidyverse, in the tidyR package, which I think I haven't loaded yet. So let's jump to the top. Let's pop to the top, you could say. And I want to load my libraries just up here, library tidyverse. Just so when you're reading the script, you can see already everything that is necessary to run it. Okay. And now we should have this table 1 in our environment. And this is some, I believe, tuberculosis data. I'm not entirely sure, but it's about cases per population. For, in this case, only a subset, only 3 different countries across 2 different years. And you can see this data is tight because every column is a feature. Like, being a country is a feature. What year the cases and population was recorded is a feature, and so are cases and population. But there are some other data sets in here which are explicitly not tidy. For example, table 2. Note that not being tidy doesn't necessarily mean it's really like messy. It doesn't look really messy. Like, everything is still laid out and has a structure. And as long as something has a defined structure, we can rearrange stuff. But we want this to be in this tidy data shape so we can work with it more easily. And what's wrong here, it's not tidy in the tidy data sense, is if we look into this column here, it says type, and then there's count. So the cases and population columns got distributed differently, and now the cases, it's actually a type of a count. So now it says cases something, and then population something. So we have 4 lines per country instead of 2. And this is wrong in the tidy data sense because type is not actually a feature, and so is count. Count by itself is not a feature. The feature is cases, and the feature is population. So we need to make cases and population explicitly their own features. They need to have their own columns and not be meshed into one column. And you could even imagine this could be the case for more than 2 columns, right? We could have multiple types in here if we had more columns here. So what we want to do is take this type column and make the elements in the type column their own column, their own features. And for this, we need to pivot this table wider. So we need the pivot wider function. So first argument, the data we are already supplying with the pipe. ID calls. ID calls we don't need to specify just yet here because it just defaults to all the other columns. Now, where do we get the names for our new columns from? And this is where we specify the type column. And where do we get the values for our new features from? And this is where we specify the count column. And if I execute this now, we can see we are back to the format which we have up here. So this is how it looked. Let me actually put this up here, so we're not forgetting how it looked like. So we're going from this to this, because we are taking the individual elements of the type column and making these the names of new columns. So everything where it's cases, the count goes in here. It gets a lot more clearer if you play around with it. All right, next example. And I'm just using these in a numeric order. So there's also table 3 after table 2. And table 2 has another problem. And this is, instead of saying cases and population, it just says rate is like cases per population. And this is harder to work for 2 reasons. One, the first reason is we have 2 features meshed into one. And the second reason is a more practical one. And this is because now these are not actual numbers as far as R is concerned. They are stored as text, as indicated by the little CHR, which stands for character in here. So we need to get these into their own columns and also make sure they are recognized as numbers so we can actually visualize them as numbers and calculate with those. So for this, we need separate, which you have probably already guessed by the subheading I added. And the first argument is the data, it's already supplied. Second argument is the column we want to separate. So we want to separate the rate into, and into is now a vector of new names that we want. And these now need to be quoted because those are not names that already exist in the data frame. Those are names we want to create, columns we want to create. So we want to separate this into cases and population. So I'm using the C function here to create a vector with 2 elements, cases and population. And now we need to specify the separator. And the separator is just this slash. And we are back to our original format. I could have been a bit more explicit here. I did not specify the names of these arguments. Sometimes I think, especially when you're starting out, it is a lot easier and clearer to read in the end if you make these explicit as well. So let's write it like that, and then it will be easier to read in the script. All right, now we are getting to pivot longer, which is the counterpart to pivot wider, which we used earlier. And for this, I'm using table for A. And there's also table for B, which we'll talk about in a second. Now, this is actually only a subset of the data. You see there's way less data points than we previously had. And this is because table for A only contains the cases. So these are the cases for Afghanistan in 1999. And here the problem is basically the opposite of what we solved with pivot wider. Here we have data that is encoded in the names of those columns. So previously we had basically column names in a column, and now we have actual data as column names. And the year is actually a feature of our data. It's a feature of the data point, so it should be its own column, its own feature. So let's take this and convert it. So we want pivot longer. And now we need to specify which columns we want. It takes a tidy select, the syntax we're using to select things. Here we could cheat a bit. We could just say everything but country. And now these names that we are gathering, they will be the year column, and the values, they are going in the cases column. And table for B has the same problem, except now it's not cases, it is actually the population. So everything but the country, names to year, and values values to population. I forgot if it's called population. Yes, it's population. And now we're back here. While we're at it, why not show you how to automate this? Because we just did the same thing, basically. There's only one slight difference. In this case, we were using cases as the name here, the name of the values column. And here we were using population. In this case, it might be a bit premature, but there's a general saying, if you copy and paste the same code 3 times, you should probably write a function. And let's just, even though we just use it 2 times, let's write a function for it. So sometimes this can also be helpful just to name the steps you're performing to make things more readable in the end. Let's call it clean to white data. And this will be a function of some data, and the values column name. So it takes the data and it pipes it into pivot longer, and then it basically does all these steps, except in, oh, I somehow deleted pivot longer. Except this one, population, is replaced by the argument of our function values. Oh, let's actually type this properly. That's not a good name for a function. Let's call it clean white data. And now we can take table for A. And clean white data, first argument is data, second argument is the values column name. So we want to set it to cases. And it does the same thing as it did up here. And now I can just copy and paste this population. And this one is table 4b. And what we didn't do yet is create new variables for this clean version. Let's call it clean. Let's call it clean 4a. Clean 4a. And clean 4b. And let's make sure to also, whoops, execute this code. And now I can show you the next step in our journey. Because one aspect of tidy data we haven't talked about yet is the idea that data that belongs together should also be in a table, like in one table. And right now we have two tables. We have the cases and the population in separate tables. We have clean A and clean B, clean 4A and 4B. But if we want to, say, calculate with those values and make graphs with those values, we really want those in the same table. And in order to do that, we need one of those join functions. So join allows you to join tables together. So we want left join in this case. Let's open up the help page here so you can see why. And it's actually the help page for all the join functions. Left join, so they both take, so all the join functions take an x and a y, which is two data sets. And left join includes all rows in x and then adds the columns from y. So in this case, it doesn't even matter if we use left, right, or full join, because they have the same, rows, number of rows, and they have the same countries and years for all those. So first one, clean 4a and clean 4b. And it automatically joins them. One thing is, we are getting this little message here that is joining by the columns country and year, because it found out those two columns are actually in both data sets and only those are different. So it joined by those. So this is the part where it stitches our tables together and it can find those out automatically. Sometimes we need to specify this. So we say by equals, and now a vector of columns that we want to use as, and in database language, these are called keys. So every data point is identified by a key. Country and yeah. And now we're getting the same result, except we're not getting this warning anymore or this message anymore, because we explicitly said what to join by. So you note also that sometimes it is nice to have everything in one table, and sometimes maybe you don't. There's only one thing you need to take care of, and that is if you want to join things, they need to have some columns in common. And those are the keys that identify what part in what table belongs together. Back to things that are concerned with a single table. And for this, let's look at table 5. And table 5 actually has a different problem. As I said, it has two problems. It has the same problem as table 3, I believe, where we had to use, let's go back here, table 3, where we had to separate the rate column into cases and population. Oops, it had the same problem here, but also there's a different problem. The year column is now separated into century and year, and those are not even specified as numbers here, they are specified as text. So let's fix this. So we need to unite, which is the opposite of separate. Not unit, unite. And the name of the new column that is going to be created comes first. So let's call it year. And then dot 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 is, well, any number of columns that we want to combine. Century and year. Now there's actually a couple of more steps, because now I just put an underscore below between those. So let's specify the separator as just an empty text. So now there's no text in between, but it is still text. And before we fix this, let's also fix the rate column while we're at it. So we separate rate into cases and population. We did this. And all these, they are now still character. So they're still text. But we want to use with those. And this is something we didn't even fix in the table number 3. So that's good that we're doing it here now. So we need to convert this into numbers. For this we can use mutate. And let's do the manual way first. So the year we want to use s.numeric and of the year column. And if we just do this, it will change the year to double. Actually, there's another function I want to show you. Let's just do it in the next step. There's the parse underscore number function, which also turns things into numbers, but it is a bit more clever than sNumeric. So sNumeric basically only works if there's only numbers in this text. And parse numbers is also able to extract numbers if there's some text around those. So this is always a very safe bet to use if you just care about getting the numbers. So same for population, parse number of population. And while we're at it, I think you are due for another trick, which I think last year I only showed at a later point, but it really fits in nicely here. What we just did is we took the same function, well, in this case a different one, but this really could have been the same function. We just took a function and applied it to three different columns, and we used three lines of code for this. And surely there must be a shorter way to do this. So let's take this part here, copy it down here. And indeed, there's a shortcut in the mutate function. We can use a function called across. And let's open up the help page on the side here. So across makes it easy to apply the same transformation. Well, I just said function. Function is just a way to do this transformation to multiple columns, allowing you to use select semantics inside data masking functions like summarize and mutate. See vignette callwise for more details. And one note here, if it says vignette callwise, you can just copy and paste this code in here, and it will open up the different help page for this. But often it is easier to just see this on the website. So here we are in the dplyr package. So we'll probably just want to go to the dplyr website and explore the help pages there. But it's nice to have things just in RStudio as well. So speaking of across, we wanted to apply the parse number function to these three columns. So how do we specify these three columns? In the cross function, I take the columns and then the functions. We need, because the first one is just one argument calls. We need to create a vector of columns, so year, cases, and population. And the functions, we could supply multiple functions in here, and in this case we only want one, parse number. Once again, it's only the function name, not with no parentheses after the function. So we're not applying it straight away, we're passing it to the function. And what I did here now is we supplied these three columns and one function. And this is year one now, basically the first function applied to the year column. I believe if we just leave out this thing, so we're just giving it one function explicitly, it applies the function and just uses the same name of the column again. So now year is actually changed to double. Before that, if we supply a named vector, for example, of functions, these names will then be used for the new column names if we apply multiple functions there, for example. So we can clean this up a bit more. It's quite explicit that the first argument is the columns and the second argument is the function. So this is one way to write it. Another way to write it, and let me just copy and paste this part, is instead of specifying these three columns here individually, we can just say, get me all the column where is.character evaluates to true. And these will be the same. Oh, actually, no, this doesn't work because it tries to convert country to a number as well. So yeah, this is an idea that doesn't work. But another way to specify is everything but the country column. And this is faster than specifying these three columns individually. Let's look at another example, which is also a dataset included in the tidyr package, and it's the billboard dataset. And this is quite interesting. Let's open it up here. It contains a bunch of tracks by different artists. So this is music, and the date it entered the, I think, American or global, I don't know, billboard. So the like top something, top 100, I think top 100 songs in the year 2000 something, for example. And this is the placement in the top 100. So in week one that it entered the top 100, then maybe this is a bit too small, but you should be able to see it, hopefully. In week one, this song by Tupac was on place number 87, and then it went to place 82, 72, and so forth. And notice that we have a new column for every single week after it entered the billboard. And most of these are actually NA, because, well, it wasn't in the top 100 anymore after, say, 40 weeks. And this is a good opportunity to talk about implicit versus explicitly missing values. So here it is very, very explicit that on week 8, there's no data here, so it says NA. If we, however, take this data set and make it longer, so we're basically making it into a tidy format, and what we want to do is the columns will be all the columns that starts with, I think, W, just RWK, more better. And now it created the name and value column automatically. So let's make this a new name, names to week, actually. And the value, values to, we need a good name for this column. I think it's the, let's call it placement. In the top 100, yes. And now notice placement is already a number, which is good, which converted these two numbers. But the week is still, it says WK1, WK2. We can fix this in multiple ways. One way would be to just go in here and say mutate week is parse number. And now we would pull out the week in here. Couldn't find parse num b. I forgot an r here. And now I just pulled out the numbers in here. But we can also, let me just copy and paste this so you can see both options in the script in the end. We can also do this in the tidyOf function already. So let's format this a little bit so we have more space to work with. We can also specify a pattern or a prefix that is then used to be removed from the column names. So the column names WK something, we just want to remove this WK. So we specify the prefix in here. And now we got week here. It is still a character. So still text data. We can also say either explicitly set the data type of our new columns. So here we say names transform, and now it wants a list of name value pairs where the name is this column name, and the value is a function to be applied to that function that column as dot integer in this case. Let's make it whole numbers. And now we're seeing the little int here. And now what we would do is call this tidy billboard, and now we can actually work with it. Just for the fun of it, let's actually build a little visualization to see how different artists or songs went after their initial placement in the top 100. Right, this is not terribly informative, so let's do the following. And I'm using this as an opportunity to show you that these aesthetic mappings apply to all geoms, but individual geoms can also have their own additional aesthetic mappings. For example, for the lines, we also want to say group by artist. Oh, actually, we want to not only group by the artist, but also by the track. And for this, we need to use the paste function, which pastes two columns together. And now it combines these individual ones. This is still not terribly informative because we can't see the names of individual songs and tracks. So while we're at it, why not show you this here. There's a package called Plotly. Let's install it. And Plotly is a different way of writing plots. But we don't need to actually be concerned with the way Plotly writes plots, because we can use a function in Plotly which takes a ggplot and converts it into a Plotly plot. So let's call it plt in here. And from the Plotly package, we want ggplotly. And this creates an interactive plot, which is quite helpful in this example, because we can hover over and see, oh, actually it doesn't show the actual name of the artist. So let's add a label here and use the same artist and track in here. Now, this is interesting in the sense that GeomPoint doesn't actually use the label in normal ggplot, but in Plotly, it uses the label to be shown down here, where it says now three doors down, for example, Kryptonite had quite an interesting path here. So most songs, they start on place 100, for example, and then they quickly go down to, say, placement 8, for example, for Lone Star Amazed. All right, let's move on and talk about some other shapes that your data can have. And I should also mention that having these data frames is not, well, the only shape data can have. In R, there's also matrices for data of the same type, and arrays, which can have multiple dimensions, so multiple dimensional matrices. But we're not using those here, because we can get basically wherever we want using just data frames. However, they might pop up at some point, and then you can Google those using maybe RStats and matrices or matrix. But another shape we are going to talk about is first lists and then nested data. I have actually used the list function today as well, and this is up here where I created a named list. So you might be thinking, what's the difference now between a vector and a list? So this is the vector and this is the list. Oh boy. They look very similar. There's one difference. So both can have names. Both can have names. The difference is that a vector can only contain data of the same type. If I put in some text here, what happens is everything gets converted into text. And this is because, well, we can't easily convert text to numbers, so it will be coerced into the format, the data format that allows the most values, and just making everything text, you're not losing any information. So if there's anything that is not a number in here, it will be converted to text, for example. With lists, this is not the case. Lists can contain data of any format. Lists can even contain other lists. And now the syntax gets a bit weird here. It also shows us how we can access those individual elements. So if we have this named x, using x underscore first, dollar first, will give us the first element of the list, if I can type it correctly, or the second element. We can also use double brackets, double square brackets, to get, for example, the third element. If we only use single square brackets, We are not getting the third element. We are getting a list which only contains the third element. So this is still packaged in a list. You can think of a list like a container train. And in this case, we are still getting a train with exactly one container. If you want to actually get the context of the contents of the container, we need to use double curly, double square brackets. And now here, the syntax is really interesting because the fourth element is actually another list. It tells us that we can get from this fourth element, the first element as well, which will be the number one. So we can chain these subsetting operations. Lists can also contain vectors, say the numbers from 1 to 5. And now the fifth element is a vector which contains the numbers from 1 to 5. And this wouldn't be possible with a normal vector. Normal vector can't have this nesting. It's only data of one type. And this is why these normal vectors are called atomic. They're not divisible anymore. So these are the atomic vectors, and this is a list. Interestingly, you have already worked with lists before without me telling you, because a data frame or a tuple. Do we actually have a data frame in here? Of course we do. We have a bunch of, like billboard, for example. A data frame is actually built on top of a list. So a data frame is nothing else than a list of columns. And now the interesting part happens. Because a data frame is just a list of columns, and lists can contain other lists as well, we can have columns that are actually lists. So previously, we only had data frames where each column was just a normal vector. So from this penguins, for example, we could get these species, and this is just a normal vector, not atomic vector. And as are all those columns in the penguins dataset. But we can have columns which are actually lists as well. And this gets sometimes handy if you want to organize things in a bit of a hierarchy. So say you have multiple data sets that you want to put into another data set just to add more context to it. So to talk about this nested data and these list columns, let's create a little example. And let's call it example, just like I did in this screenshot up here. I'm using the function tibble to create a tibble, and I'm just basically creating the same example I created last time. And this now looks really weird here in this view, but we have the normal vector column X, but we also have this list column Y. And the first element of the list column is a character vector of length 1. And if we look into this, how we specified it here, we know this element is hello. And the second one is a logical vector, so yes or no of length 1. In this case, it's true. And the third element of this list column Y is an atomic vector of integers of whole numbers of length 4. And these are the numbers from 1 to 4 we put in there. And this can be easier to see in this environment panel, where we can just click on this little drop-down menu and we see how our example is structured. We can also control click it. It will open it. Oh no, this doesn't work because there's also a function named example. We can also type view example and it will open up here. And this is actually able to show this, interestingly. Let's talk about list columns which might actually occur in the wild by using some data set you already know. Let's talk about the Palmer penguins. And what I want to do is create a nested data set. Let's open up the help page using F1 on the side. So nesting creates a list column of data frames, and unnesting is the opposite operation. So nesting is a bit like summarizing data, but instead of summarizing something to just one value or a couple of values, we're just putting everything into one package and we are leaving it in this list column. Say, for example, we want to nest all the data but not the island. I think now this can be fun, I think, yeah. But not the island. And now we only have the island column because all the other data is nested in this list column. It gives us a little warning because they actually made the syntax a bit more readable. So now we have to specify in the form new column and then the columns that are supposed to be nested. So let's call it data. And this is everything but the island. So we need to explicitly give it a new name. So this is our previous data. And all the data about the species and the bill lengths, flipper lengths, and all that is now nested just in this data column. We can control click it here to open it up, and it shows us we have the island column, and then we have the list column, which contains these data frames. And in here, if we click it, it also shows us how we can access individual data frames in our nested data. So for example, what we could do now is take the nested data. This would now be the complete list and just get the first element. And this is now only the data about, let's see what's the first species, about the first island, about the island Torgeson. We can get the data back out of this nested format by using the unnest function. Unnest. And it takes the column we want to unnest. We call it data. And now we're back into this regular format where we have our island column and then all the data. So now you have seen how we can take data that is too wide or too long and make it wider or longer. We can separate columns. We can unite columns. We can even take data and nest it into each other and unnest it again. And the exercises will be concerned with making data tidy, turning data from different shapes into each other, and then also using the advantages of tidy data to build visualizations or create summaries of your data. And I'll see you in the seminar.